Good morning, grade nines. Welcome back to today's class. I see we're not very much participants this morning. I think it's because it's Friday and it's a bit chilly here in Gauteng. I'm not sure where you guys are all situated, but perhaps it's cold there as well. Remember I said yesterday we're quickly going to go on with this and then do the exercise, and then we will be finishing up with this PowerPoint. What I've done is I've put in the page number here for you. So if you've got this book here, Afrikaans Handbook and Study Guide, an English student's guide to Afrikaans. Remember I said this is the Bible for English students to learn Afrikaans. You can open it up on page 14. I quickly want to just run through this and then do the activity. Okay, so I see Tabile is on, Charlton and Boost. Okay, so I remember Charlton and Tabile. I didn't think Boost is, can't remember perhaps. But anyway, welcome again. Let's quickly do bijvoeglijke naamwoorden adjectives. So remember here, bijvoeglijke naamwoorden and English adjectives. And I quickly want to run through this. And I know it's a lot of work, but we have to do this. I want to make sure that you understand this work properly. Okay, so if I've got a bijvoeglijke naamwoord, an adjective, that will be the columns that's with the normal word. But sometimes, and it's mostly going to be like this in a test or exam, you have to, teacher might give you a sentence, but that's what we're going to practice just later on. And she's going to say, or he's going to say, listen, you must put the word into the sentence so that it fits into the sentence. And therefore, this is why I quickly want to run through the spelling rules of adjectives. Okay, so you know now by this time what is the vowel and consonants and so on. So what we're going to do is if I've got a word, look at that sentence, die seep is glad, and it's got a short vowel in, look there, short vowel, before we have a consonant at the back. You see, short vowel and then a consonant, short vowel and consonant. In order for that word to fit into the sentence properly, the short consonant's going to, well, not the short consonant, the consonant's going to double, and I'm going to put an E there. Die seep is glad. I can't say die glad seep nie, so I'm going to say die gladde seep. Die dag is genotvol, die genotvolle dag. Do you see there the consonant doubled? Oh, sorry. Twin vowels then. If I've got a word and it's got twin vowels followed by a consonant, remember, twin vowels, they look the same. Then the one twin's going to eat up the other twin, and it's going to get an E at the back. Look there. Vreed becomes vrede. The one twin falls away, and it gets an E at the back. Sparsham, sparsham. The one twin ate the other one, so only one A and an E at the back. Sparsham. You must tell me if I'm too quickly, please, guys. Double consonants. Okay, so two consonants at the back of the word, then it only gets an E. So hard word harder. So if the word ends on two consonants, you simply add an E at the back. Now, here is a part where you have to concentrate with these three here. The first one, if I've got a short vowel followed by an F, that F's not happy. He says, I want an extreme makeover. Then he goes for an extreme makeover and he becomes a double W. So a vowel followed by an F, short vowel followed by an F. F becomes two W's followed by an E. However, if I've got a twin vowel, vowels that look the same, followed by an F, then one of the one W. See, they do have a half, halve. If I've got a double consonant at the end, but one of the consonants is an F, do you see there? L, F, R, F. Again, the F is going to change into a W, and I'm adding an E. Just like with that one, where was it earlier? There. If it ends on a consonant, it always gets an E. But that F is going to change in a V. So remember here, F's always change into V's. It's only with a short vowel where the where we get two W's. Right, guys. Now, if I've got a short vowel followed by G, short vowel followed by G, look there, short G, sach for instance, then I'm going to add a TE. So just quickly go back. With all those ending on an F, make a little star or something there. If you've got the book, if you've only got this in front of you here, then write a note there. If it ends on an F, it usually changes to a V. All right, long vowels. If I've got long vowels followed by a G, then, and this is an important one, most of the time you will have a deal taken here added to the word. Wig becomes were, deal taken. Laag, this is a exception, becomes IE without the deal taken. Moog, look at the spelling. We've got the oo sound still and it only gets a deal taken ear. Vroeger, oo sound only gets a deal taken ear. Now, leeg, and another exception. You see here, it only gets a deal taken ear. But you see there, it's not three E's there. So guys, with this rule, it's only pure studying. You must go and study, 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 study this rule. And you can also look at, I'm sure that you guys have textbooks. Go and look at the textbooks under bijvoeglijke naamwoorden as well. Now, a long vowel, followed by a D. Long vowel followed by a D. The D becomes an E, or it gets a E sound. But look there, again, three exceptions. Coat, the D becomes the E. Breed becomes A. That one actually belongs there. Breer becomes a deal taken ear. Weit, weie. Oat, oman. And in Afrikaans, there's this saying, and I think it's the same in English. If it doesn't sound right, it's probably not right. I think it's more like that in English. But you can't say the oatman. Where's my last now? The oatman. You're going to have to say the oman. So again, it's about sounding right. Do it, do it, yeah. I can't say the do it book. Goed, I can't say the goed kind, nie, so I say the goeie kind. So this one as well, study it hard. Now, words ending on a lik. If I've got a word like smakelijk or moeilijk, it ends on the lik sound. Then it only gets an E at the back. The smakelijke kos, die moeilijke som. Words ending on a IG. Tuin is prachtig, IG, besig, IG, it only gets an E. Now this is an important one, the next one. If I've got a word, an adjective, I'm actually speaking about adjectives, nay. If I've got an adjective ending on an ing, but in English, then it gets a E-N-D-E sound, an inde sound. So look there, kook in English is boiling. Boiling has got an E-N-G at the back, which means in Afrikaans, the word will become E-N-D-E at the back. Sink, sinking, sinkende. Sing, singing, singende. Okay, see, we're very little students this morning. I'm telling you it's because of it's Friday. Okay, just something here as well. Colors in Afrikaans never change in a sentence, adjective. So if the rock is rooi, it's the rooi rock. If the sneeuw is wit, die wit sneeuw. You see that the color stays the same. But exception, goud becomes goue. I think the same rule apply with that one there, the long vowel. However, it doesn't get a deal taken ear. Now guys, the following words don't change. I am not going to run through all of that. I might just sleep as well. So I'm just going to do two of them. Patiënt, the patient is sick. So you see that doesn't change. We're going to say the sick patiënt. Die drijver is sier, die sier drijver. Die hoentje is bang, die bang hoentje. Okay, so these words never change. Again, you must go and study these words. But words expressing emotion gets an E. So look here. Die straatkinders is arm, die arm straatkinders, nee? However, if I say die bedelaar is arm and I put I will say die arme patiënt, that arm refers to an emotion. That's why it only gets an E. Die afscheid was bitter. So The greeting was very sad. Nee, die bittere afscheid. Coffee is bitter. It describes the bitterness of coffee. Yeah, the afscheid was bitter. It describes the emotional goodbye. Then it becomes bittere afscheid. So study this. And then more exceptions. Die man is lank, lang man. Die seun is jonk, jong seentjie. Die klere is niet nieuwe klere. Again, I'm telling you, if it sounds right, it's probably right. If it sounds wrong, it's probably wrong. But you can't rely on that always because it's only so in most of the cases. So you must go and study this. Okay, so that was bijvoeglijke naamwoorden in this book. Now we're going to do an exercise. And Yolishwa, Tabili, Charlton, and Boost, we are going to work together today. If you want to say the answers over the mic, you are welcome. If you want to chat it, you are welcome, depending on what your choice is. But let's do this exercise quickly. Okay, so got a little guy there. He's sitting there, ready for this Friday class. Good. I want you to go to that resource. If you've got time during your studying for the term, before you do a test or something again, write this down. You can use that resource there to learn about more bijvoeglijke naamwoorden and adjectives. Okay, so take a snappy of this when we are done. All right, guys. They say there, gee die correcte vorm van die bijvoeglijke naamwoord tussen hakkies. In other words, we must change the adjective so that it fits into the sentence. Now, Suid-Afrika is a fantastisch land vir toerisme. South Africa is a fantastic country for tourism. That fantastisch doesn't fit into that sentence, so we must change it. Now remember, if a word ends on a long vowel, ending with a consonant, what is it going to get in the end? It's going to get an E. Fantastic. Now it's your time to answer. Ons land bied 'n groot verskeidenheid en interessant. Excuse. Ons land bied 'n groot en interessant verskeidenheid aan elke toerist. Our country gives a big and interesting variety to every tourist. Sorry, I have to sometimes translate it directly in English, then I sound like something, like a robot, something went wrong. Okay, so ons bied 'n groot interessant verskeidenheid aan elke toerist. What is that word going to turn into? Double consonant. Think of what the rule says. Interessante. Nee? It's a T-E at the back. Well, the E, sorry. Okay, now you're going to do this yourself. Om die kabelkar na Tafelberg te ry is 'n gewild keuse. Ends on two consonants. What's it going to get? I want to see Tabile. Guys, please try and type something there. I know it's early in the morning. I hope you had some coffee or tea. What is that word going to change into? Om die kabelkar na Tafelberg te ry is 'n gewilde keuse. Yolishwa, what do you think it's going to be? How is gewild going to change? Guys, too early? Okay, so remember again, if a word ends on two consonant, it gets an E, gewilde. Right, next one. In die Magaliesberge is daar kleurvol ballon, lichtballonne. Ends on a short vowel, followed by a consonant. What is going to happen there? Charlton, what do you say? How is kleurvol going to change? Okay, thank you so much, Charlton. If Tabile gave us the answer there. Thank you, Tabile. It will be kleurvolle. You see there? Double consonant. And it gets an E. Well done. Next one. In Durban is daar die helder water om in te ski, scuba en branders ry. In Durban there is very clear water om to ski, scuba and I'm probably going to say the surf. Okay. In Durban is daar die helder water. This is something that you have to think about. Ends on a short vowel followed by an R, but it's not gonna follow, it's not gonna be the same rule there actually. Think of your superlative form then. Think of the superlative form. Charlton, would you like to try? You will boost maybe? Alderste, thank you, Tabile. Joeg, jy is op en wakker so vroeg in die morgen. Well done. Okay, die groot mensgemaakte gat in die wereld is in Kimberley. Ends on A. Twin vowel with a T. With the consonant at the back, what's going to happen? Same rule applies there. Grootste, thank you, Elishwa. Okay, toeriste wat limoene in die Gamtoosvallei in die Ooskaap koop, is beslis slim as die wat in die winkels gaan koop. Ends on a short vowel followed by a consonant. What's going to happen there? Slimmer. Thank you, Boost. Okay, guys. Die lang rye van motors by die Walter Sisulu Nasionale Botaniese Tuin in Gauteng is 'n goed aanduiding dat dit 'n gewild plek is. Okay, are we going to say here the lang rye? Die lang rye van die motors by die Walter Sisulu Nasionale Botaniese Tuin in Gauteng is 'n, what's that going to be? Is 'n aanduiding. Twin vowel, followed by a D. Okay, aanduiding, dat dit 'n gewild plek is. Okay, so long as correctly the tabile. Okay, gewild, there it ends on two consonants, it's only going to get something at the back. Goed. I'm going to give you that answer. Goeie. Okay, thank you, Tabile. Good, goeie. And then gewilde. Look at the answer there. Die lang rye van die motors by die Walter Sisulu Nasionale Botaniese Tuin Gauteng is 'n goeie aanduiding dat dit 'n gewilde plek is. You guys are very clever. In Limpopo sal jy vroeg, remember jy, nee? It's something followed by a G. Twin vowels, long vowels followed by a G. What's going to happen there? In Limpopo sal jy vroeg as gewoonlik moet opstaan wanneer jy in die kreerwildtuin is. Met sonsopkoms jag die leeu's maklik omdat hulle honger is. Ends on a lick, what's going to happen there? Vroeg, it's makliker. Yes, Boost, that's definitely the answer, makliker. What's vroeg going to become? Remember, it is a long vowel followed by a G. What's going to happen there? Take your time, guys. This is a very important one. Remember, it's one of those things that I said you have to go and study. Okay, I think I'm going to go with the answer here. So it will become vroeger. Do you see there? The U sound is still there, but it gets a deelteken E and then a R, vroeger, because we can't say vroeger as gewoonlik. We actually can. No, it's not going to fit into that sentence, vroeger. Okay, met sonsopkoms jag die leeu's makliker. Guys, I'm really impressed with you guys. It's fine, Boost, don't worry. Okay, second last one. Dalstroom is bekend vir sy moeg vissermanne. Dis die goed plek om vlieghengel te doen. Same rule applies. Where did I see that? Moeg en goed, the same. Ends on a vowel followed by a G. No, it's only going to be bester when we do degrees of comparison. Dalstroom is bekend vir sy moeg vissermanne. Think there, look at my mouse. Okay, Dis 'n goed plek om van te hengel. Guys, look there, I'm giving you a tip. Are you guys with me? Hulström is bekend vir sy moegvissermanne. I'm going to count till 5 and then I'm going to give the answer. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, Boost, you're almost there, my boy. Or girl, I'm not sure. Moegbeeste. Oh, sorry, you know what? I'm wrong there. Who gave that answer? Boost, you were right. It's going to be beeste. What's going on with my brain this morning? So, Boost, thank you so much. You were right. Okay, so moe, look there, and beeste. Okay. Om net vir 'n half dag deur die klein Karoo te ry, sal jy weer die stilte en die mooi van die wyd vlaktes laat waardeer. So, wyd ends with a D. Something's going to happen there. It was an exception. Elishwa, goeie. Okay, so we're done with that one, my dear. Half, om net vir 'n half dag. Remember, that F went for a extreme makeover. So, what happened there? Went for an extreme makeover and it got something with it. Let's see. I'm pretty sure you're going to remember this one. Okay, so Boost, not quite. Tabile, are you almost there? So it's going to be halve with, and remember it's only one, it's a two consonants at the back, which means it's only going to be one W. Okay, sal jy weer die stilte en die van die wye vlaktes wys. So the halve. If it ends on two consonants, it becomes only one W. Thank you, Lishwa. And then wye. Okay, because it ends on a D, so it might change into an E. Okay. Guys, before we go to the next PowerPoint, I want to quickly know, I have my pen and my book here. Who wants this PowerPoint? And if you want this PowerPoint, you must quickly send me an email to that email address. So if you want this PowerPoint, and I think almost think that a Charlton asked, or Yulishwa, you maybe ask for that. So Yulishwa wants it. Take that email address here, that you see there, Melissa, two S's, pinar.atg@gmail.com. And send me a blank email. So take a snappy of this screen and then you can send me the email. If you send me a blank email, just say, well, it won't be blank. You say, ma'am, grade 9, Yulishwa, and I'll send you this this PowerPoint. Okay. There's my email address. I want you to send me an email with your name and your grade, and I will then sent this email to you. So I'm just going to make a note here. So Yulishwa, you want it. I've spoken to somebody yesterday who's going to help me with a Google Drive thing. So that person, if they're going to help me, I'm going to put the PowerPoints in there as well for you guys. But in the meantime, it's very important. Send me a blank email. If not a blank email, if I say that one more time, I'm going to eat myself with this pen. So send me an email to that email address and then I'll quickly give it to you. We've only got a few seconds left before I'm going to go to the next slide, guys. I think we must go to the next PowerPoint. Okay, can I go on? Will you just give me an indication? Thank you, ma'am. Okay, great. Let's go to the next PowerPoint. Okay, so today we are going to study also. Let me just get this one out here. Okay. Indicate to me if you can see this. Okay. With this lesson, you are going to have to focus like never before, because we are going to do two very, very, very important, what happened now? To do two very important woordsoorte or parts of speech. And it might seem easy because, you know, if you've studied this from a very long time ago, and it is actually very easy as soon as you actually get it. But because this is slightly more difficult than zelfstandige naamwoorden and bijvoeglijke naamwoorden, I've put in a lot of resources for you guys to go and actually study it by heart yourself. So, you know most my email address now, so I'm going to skip through this. You also know how I look. So, ons focus nou vandag op werkwoorde en bijwoorde. At some stage, I'm going to have to speak a bit more Afrikaans. So, but then I'll speak very slowly. Another name for werkwoorde in Afrikaans is vegtes. So you might get that in some of your textbooks. Werkwoorde is also known as gesegdes, and then in English, just for your convenience, it will be seen as verbs. Okay, what do we know about verbs? Wat ons weet, what we weet, wat ons weet, is dat a werkwoord by a actie of a handeling aan. In English, it's an action word. Nee, it's known in Afrikaans as doen woorde, doing words. Again, it's an action word. Okay, Yulishwa, thank you, my love. It's doing words. Yes, you're correct. And now focus. I think if you've got a pen and paper with you now, write this down. The first one we get is a zelfstandige werkwoord. And underneath the first one, there is four. Oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik, wederkerig. The second main type is hulpwerkwoorde. And underneath it, it's tydwyse in vorm. Okay. And the third main one is koppelwerkwoorde. And the fourth is infinitief. Take a picture or write those down quickly. Remember, there's four types: zelfstandige werkwoorde, hulpwerkwoorde, koppelwerkwoorde, infinitief. But the first two has got four things underneath it as well. Zelfstandige werkwoorde has got oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik, wederkerig. En hulpwerkwoorde has got tydwyse vorm. So if you haven't taken a picture, I'm quickly going to give about 10 seconds for you to write that down. And then I'm going to make a promise today. I've promised my grade 8 yesterday as well, because this is a revision that we're going to do for the next week with all the woordsoorte. And I've promised that I'm going to give you a nice summary of all of this, and it's my pleasure. So I'm going to make you a nice summary for you, and I'm going to hopefully have it ready by Monday with the Google Drive, and then I'll give you it. Or I'm just going to put it into the PowerPoint and you can take a snappy of it. Okay, my darlings, can I go on to say yes or no? Let me see. If I get two yeses, I'm going on. Okay, Yulishwa and Tabile. Okay, great, I'm going on. Okay, so the first main one is then zelfstandige werkwoorde. Look at the picture there. This guy is running and he's kicking a ball. Nee, so now we know it's a typical werkwoord. So, zelfstandige werkwoorde is words that can stand alone in the sentence. So, I can alleen staan in a sin. And there is four types, like I've explained to you earlier. The first one is oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik, and wederkerend is the last one. So, when we look at zelfstandige werkwoorde oorganklik, this is now the first one that we're going to do. And oorganklik. Now I'm going too quickly. So we get zelfstandige werkwoorde, and the first type of zelfstandige werkwoord is oorganklik. And here you must put your thinking cap on. Dit word deur 'n voorwerp gevolg. So it will be the verb in the sentence, and just after the verb, there will be an object. And if you want to test it, you can ask yourself, wie en wat word aangedui in die oorganklik? It can tell us about who and what. And an example here. Die man eet 'n appel. Eet is die oorganklike werkwoord, want na hom is die voorwerp. Look there. Eet is the verb, the oorganklike verb. Because after it, there is the object, die appel. En wie eet die appel? Die man. Wat eet die man? Hy eet die appel. Do you see how I tested it there? So, oorganklik is a verb followed by an object. Verb followed by an object. Okay, I'm going to the next slide. Selfstandige werkwoorde onoorganklik. So this is the second type of selfstandige werkwoord. Okay, onoorganklik, which means daar word nie 'n voorwerp gevolg nie. So we get the verb here, but there's no object coming behind it. Look there, hulle ry ver. So ry is the verb and then ver vertel vir my van hoe hulle ry. So if they are riding far or something. Yeah, my English is not very good. Okay, so in ander woorde, hulle ry ver. Ver vertel vir my van hoe hulle ry. It's telling me how they are driving. So onoorganklik, no object behind the verb. So it's not at all the same. Number 3, selfstandige werkwoorde, onpersoonlik. This is actually, you must see ice here. If you've ever watched Frozen, look at the ice queen here. Because this is very impersonal. Selfstandige werkwoorde, onpersoonlik. It tells us something that it doesn't refer to something specific. So it's ice cold. So it's not a specific dier or persoon or thing. You're not saying Mary, you're saying dit. And you're not saying, you're not referring to somebody with very much emotion. Dit reën al lank in die Karoo. Look at that dit. Dit reën al lank in die Karoo. You see there, it's almost like it's a cold type of sentence. Reën dui nie op iets spesifiek nie. So that rain doesn't really refer to something specifically. Dit reën al lank in die Karoo. Reën dui nie op iets spesifiek nie. Okay. Make a little note of this one. Then the last one, selfstandige werkwoorde wederkerend. This is a very nice one. It's almost like we're dancing when we say that. Die onderwerp en die voorwerp is dieselfde. The subject and the object is the very same thing. Byvoorbeeld, hy vererg hom. He's getting annoyed with him. So hy en hom refers to the same person. You see that they're almost dancing. Hy en hom is the same person. But we must note the following. Soms is die werkwoorde altyd wederkerig. Sometimes the verbs are always wederkerig. For instance, sy was die motor. Nie haarself nie, daar is 'n direkte voorwerp. Dis oorganklik. Sy was die motor. So this is an exception. Sometimes the verb is always wederkerig. Sy was die motor. You see there, there's only, sy refers to herself in the sentence as well, but there's not another word that dances with the word sy. Okay, I'm going to go back quickly because this is something you must understand. Oorganklik, selfstandige werkwoorde, oorganklik, refers to a verb followed by a object. Selfstandige werkwoorde, onoorganklik. There is no object in this sentence. It's only the verb followed by a word that will tell me more about the verb, but it's not an object. Selfstandige werkwoorde, onpersoonlik. The frozen verb, because it doesn't have any emotion in it. It just tells me about dit reën al lank hier in die Karoo. Just a simple sentence. Then the dance one, wederkerend. Hy vererg hom. Which means the hy and the hom is the same thing, but sometimes it's that little verb or that wederkerend there refers to the very same person. Nee, was would be the verb in that sentence. Okay, can I have an indication if you all understand and are with me? Let me hear from you guys. Hello. Yes, Tabili understands. I want to hear from all of you. I want all of you to say yes, ma'am, or no, ma'am. Boost understands. Elisha understands. Tabili understands. What's next? Who's next? Onkabetsi, yes, great. They still. What about Charlton? You understand? Great. Okay, so I'm going on to the next slide then. Okay, guys, now the second main type of werkwoord is hulpwerkwoord. Now look at that picture. It's hands supporting each other. Nee. So this werkwoord, a hulpwerkwoord, supports the main verb. So it's helping the main verb. Okay, so a hulpwerkwoord cannot stand alone in a sentence. Cannot stand alone. And it helps the selfstandige werkwoord to give more meaning. And there's three types. Tijd, wijze, vorm. In other words, think of it this way. We're going to have a verb in a sentence. And then there's going to be a hulpwerkwoord that tells us when that verb, in terms of time, manner, or form. Okay. Look here. A hulpwerkwoord van tijd. See your watch in front of you now. It's going to give meaning on the zelfstandige werkwoord in terms of time. Gives meaning to the verb in terms of time. Gee betekenis aan die zelfstandige werkwoord in termen van tijd. En een example. Aantjie het 'n gedig in die Afrikaanse klas geskryf. Geskryf is my verb. I cannot now say, Aantjie 'n gedig in die Afrikaanse klas geskryf. I need help. That verb needs help to give more understanding. And it's going to be het. Het tells us about the time that geskryf happened. Aantjie het 'n gedig in die Afrikaanse klas geskryf. Now, a hulpwerkwoord van wijze. I think in English it's manner. It helps a hoofwerkwoord om te kyk of die aksie waarskynlik of moontlik is. In English, the main verb is used to determine whether the action is even possible. Voorbeeld, Aantjie mag in die Afrikaanse klasse gedig skryf. Skryf is my main verb. Mag tells me something about the manner. May she write it? Is it even possible for her to write it? Aantjie mag in die Afrikaanse klas 'n gedig skryf. Juffrou, is dit adverbs in English? Onka Betsy, we're going to get to adverbs later, but this is, you actually get a verbs that's also telling me about time, manner, and form. So this is not adverbs yet. I was also surprised the first time I actually studied this. So this is still just hulpwerkwoorde, and hulpwerkwoorde can also help a sentence, hulpwerkwoord van tyd, plek en wyse. Okay, so Onka Betsy, I hope that was, okay, you said, thank you, teacher. Okay, hulpwerkwoord van vorm, so this is form. This helps a hoofwerkwoord om te kyk of die aksie waarskynlik of moontlik is. So it helps the main verb to see if the action is even possible. Die gedig is deur Aantjie geskryf. Geskryf is again my verb, and is is my hulpwerkwoord. It helps to give meaning to the main verb, because I cannot say die gedig deur Aantjie geskryf. It will not even make a bit of sense. Nee. Okay, so now we've done, to go back, we've done two types of verbs here now. So hulpwerkwoord van tyd, wyse en vorm. Now, the third main type of verb is koppelwerkwoorde. And this is almost like, you must see electrical cords here. So it connects stuff together. Okay, I don't know how many of you have ever opened a computer, but you'll see there's a lot of wires and stuff that work together, and buttons and little quickies. And that is how koppelwerkwoorde work. Okay, so koppelwerkwoorde. There I've given you the koppelwerkwoorde. Words like is, was, word, like, yet, skyn, lay, en klink. And if you've got that book that I've spoken about in the previous PowerPoint, that English Afrikaans book, then you'll see them in there as well. I see our time's almost up. Okay, I'm going to stop here. So, tomorrow I'm sleeping in. On Monday, we're going to finish this PowerPoint koppel werkwoorde. Just lastly, I'm quickly running. Okay, this is going to take forever.